just because I think I was like halfway drunk when I was doing it, and I was kind of nervous too.
On the when you were on Bad Christian, that was like our 10th episode like or something.
I think it was the 13th. And I just can't. And you picked it up though. I remember you were like, Seth, this sounds kind of serious, but you're just like making light of it. And so, I was like, well, yeah, I guess so. And it's just.
People deal all kind of ways with being in front of a microphone. It's insane. Yeah. It, you know, if you just look at it and pay attention and study the way people, not you don't have to study, but it's so bizarre what using a microphone does to something in your psychology. And it has to do with fear of public speaking, I guess. Right. So there's the technique of talk. You wouldn't even think technique of using a mic is a big deal. But whether you're here or inconsistent or just confident to talk in the thing versus hold it like Bob Barker or whatever, there's so much to it. But it triggers something in people if they're talking about – it's the same thing that's when somebody holds up a camera and you all of a sudden you think they're recording and now right. You start acting weird.
Yeah. It exacerbates everything that maybe you're scared of.
Yeah, it's just it's a public speaking fear, but this instead of seeing – 10,000 people or 30,000 people or 30 people, this represents that you're public speaking, essentially, right. Just because there's a microphone here. So you feel all stilted and careful and weird, and, you know, it just changes everything for people. But it's weird because you don't even know how many people. So not only am I scared to talk to a lot of people.
Well, maybe it's
not. Is it a million? Is it 10? Because you talk differently to 10 people versus 1,000 people versus 100
people. Well, yeah, but probably maybe the numbers don't even matter. It's like knowing that you're doing it and knowing that somebody else is listening to you intently. That's what it is. Because if you have a microphone, it's not like you can have a side conversation over here in the corner or anything like that. It's like, okay, everything that I say, 10 people or 10,000 people is going to be heard right now.
But if you're around, you and me and Toby are sitting here talking, I know you're very focused and intently listening to what I'm saying, but it doesn't matter. It's fine.
I think it matters to the person talking in the microphone, whether you're used to it or not.
Yeah, the microphone's, it's confusing because who knows how many people are listening even. It's almost weirder than talking to a crowd because at least you know what the crowd
says. So in the early days or even now, since I'm starting to do this more, I'm not thinking like, oh, is there 10 people listening to what I say? Is there 20? Oh, no, please, not 30.
Yeah,
I better really do good.
But let me back you up on that. If I weren't here, you would. Like, let's. Uh-huh. What if I say right now, you know what? I got to make a phone call. Just keep on going with it. Oh. Now you will feel the pain. You will feel the fear immediately. You go, excuse me. You'll get all weird.
Okay, so.
You want to try it? I'll split.
No, you could. Well, I don't know what I would talk about to your listeners or not.
You'd get real self-aware real quick, is what I'm saying.
Well, you would get self-aware, but I'm kind of used to it because as a therapist, that's what I do for a job, right? I'm the main person. If the other person's not talking, it's either an intentional moment of silence or they're thinking, okay,
there's a lot of
what is my therapist going to, what is he going to say? You know, they're going to say something insightful or good or leading or, you know, whatever. So just like, it's always focused on the therapist.
Very intentional. I mean, it's not a crowd still.
Yeah, it's not a crowd, but.
Why do you think that is? People are so scared of public speaking. I mean,
like I said, I think that's like the number one fear, right? According to research says, you know, I don't know. I think maybe because public speaking kind of goes into that like primal fear of like everybody is watching me. It's all dependent me whether what I say or don't say. They will, you know, conclude, oh, is this person smart? Is it competent? Is he a goofball? Is he funny? Is he insightful? You know. So maybe that's...
Let me float two theories then. One would be, if you were, let's say it was primal or primitive or whatever, if a bunch of people are listening to one person analyzing them, it means one of two things. Either they're in trouble, like being evaluated for judgment, or they're in charge, both of which are very dangerous predicament. Right. To be in charge is dangerous. Like if you're in charge of these 200 people. Holy
shit. Let's do it.
People would challenge me. I might fail. I got to be unbelievably careful now. I'm in charge of 200 people because why else would they all be listening to me speak?
It's almost
or you're being held up there and, I don't know, judged and analyzed. Either way, it's a very serious situation. If
every time you get a mic is an instant promotion, no matter what you do, right? Yeah. It's like, boom, okay, you're up here, speak, you know, share knowledge or whatever.
But where we're headed is, everything's good. Like, it won't be hard for there to be cameras and microphones all the time everywhere streaming connected to your lens or your glasses or your backpack. 24/7 streaming of video and microphone.
Right. Then we'll just get used inevitable. To it. Just like, yeah. I bet talking on the phone was like that at one point, you know? It's like, oh, I'm talking to the phone. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like way back.
It was
back,
formal. You're
it
right.
Was, it was
phone
formal.
Phone calls
was like,
were more formal.
It was long distance, you know? So like, well, some long distance, it costs money. There was mm-hmm. something at stake. You're on the phone. I don't want to waste the other person's time if I don't have anything to talk about, you know? So it was like very kind of, so maybe public speaking will be as ubiquitous as having an iPhone.
Well, I mean, this is not giving a speech, right? Like, I can talk, we don't have a plan of what we're going to talk about right now.
No.
And we know we're talking to a lot of people. That never happened before.
That's funny.
That's never been a thing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But now it is, so it's interesting.
So think about like from playing shows and stuff, like what's the biggest crowd you've probably ever played in front of?
We played 5,000 people in a room,
in one room.
I think we played for more outdoor or something, but that doesn't feel the same. We played for 5,000 people in Sydney.
Yeah.
And it's just, I just
so that's huge, right? I mean, so that's, okay, you're up there, all eyes on you, 10,000 eyes on you, right? So, but with this medium, there's way more people listening
than would be
in a room, you know, mm-hmm. 10, 20, 30.
But
50?
Each one of them feels like they're sitting right here. They don't feel like they're in a crowd when they listen, is what you get away with in podcasting, because they don't feel like they're listening to a speech from me. They feel like they're sitting in the empty seat right beside you.
Yeah.
And each one of the crowd has that experience. So they're actually
And then
never,
they have their own independent thoughts like, oh, well, I would say this.
But there is no crowd.
There.
So when you say, 20,000 people are listening to this, yes, individually.
Yeah.
That's totally different. It's not
that's
a crowd.
That's crazy. That's crazy. Just think about like where, well, that, I mean, I guess that's why the new, you know, I can't even think of the word I'm going to say, how popular podcasts are becoming, you know, because it is so intimate, you know. It's like, I'm sure you've heard a zillion times, like when people finally meet you, you know, with a bad Christian thing or whatever, or break it down thing, it's like, oh yeah, I feel like I've known you, you know, like, oh yeah, I know Bridget. And it's like, no, you don't know, you know, but you only know of what you tell people about, you know what I'm saying? So mm-hmm. it's just like being in a living room, just talking. And are podcasts fake then?
Fake?
Yeah.
How would they be
is
fake?
Is it just a replacement for people not
surrogate
connected?
For real?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
No, I don't think so. There's a ton that you learn when you're listening to a podcast. So it could be a surrogate for conversation in real life in some sense, because you can listen to people that maybe know more and more interesting than the person that lives at your domestic residence, right?
Yeah.
So yes, but you also, I think of it as a form of learning and a form of gathering information and a form of studying, mm-hmm. basically. So I like conversation and conversational dialogue, and I feel like since I know how to have a conversation, and I've been in many, I can get more out of hearing somebody speak casually in a conversation than I can hearing their prepared speech.
Right.
Because their prepared speech carries with it all the fact that it's calculated and revised, and now I don't have a good... It's akin to body language. Like when you see body language, you go, oh, that helps you understand what the person meant. When you get a text out of the blue, you don't know what they meant, what the context is. And a prepared speech takes away a lot of context from, oh, but if you heard that same person talk on that topic conversationally to another intelligent person, I think you would get more out of that. It takes longer to do, because conversation is inherently less efficient than a speech.
And that's why you feel closer to podcast host than you do some professor mm-hmm. at a lecture or something that you've heard.
Right.
Huh.
Yeah. Exactly. But the weird thing that you asked me before was like, what's going on is, I think there's three levels of what's going on, and I'm not a multitasker person, but mm-hmm. I do consider speaking and podcasting, there is a multitask function going on, because you have to be aware of what you're saying,
right?
And you have to be aware of how it's coming across. Like, I have to have the thought and speak it, and then I also have to filter how do they hear it, and does it make sense to the person I'm imagining listening to this. Do they need more background? Does that sit right?
Although so you have to take in the content of what you're saying. You have to take in the context
of what
you're saying.
You have to create the content.
Yeah.
Well, manage the context.
And create, well, you have to create all those things. And then, so for me, I'm like, if I'm telling a story, then I want to like kind of go back and make sure that my listener has the entire context. And usually that comes out as just, you know.
But that can be a huge, it's necessary, long-winded. But it can be a huge mistake, because it's like you just keep backing up and backing up. That's one of my pet peeves, listen to a podcast or when I'm doing one and it goes weird. It's like, oh, you were trying to back up to explain something, and then you backed up from that, and then you backed up from that.
Okay,
and
so
and often you don't even get back to what you're saying. It's
so let's make this conversation a real practice for me in that.
Okay, good.
I'm not going to do any. Well, I'll do the backstory enough that I think maybe, but if you think it's not, then you go.
I'll let you know,
dude. Chill.
And that brings me to the third thing, which is managing the person that you're talking to. So I have to also think ahead. Like, you're going to answer a question in a minute, and then you're just going to look at me,
right?
And I don't want to have a prepared question there.
Yeah.
So I have to stay engaged with you so that goes well. So I'm not caught off guard, or else I have to look down notes or whatever. Like, what did I want to ask? Tell me about a time that once you go there, it's kind of sunk.
We were talking before. So is my job as a licensed therapist, right? I promise you. So when I have a client or, a couple or whatever, they're looking to me just like your guest is looking to you as the podcast host, mm-hmm. right? So I kid you not, there have been so many times where, the client says something, like, an adult client paying you, a lot of money expecting something from you. And I promise you, I make a face. I'm not kidding. I make a face and go, I just start talking. I say, mm-hmm. like an example, you just tell me something hard and I literally don't know what to say. Mm-hmm. I'm like, well, like, did you ever think about, like, what your mom would think about that? That's just really generic.
You just say something nonsense.
I promise you, like, I can be two words in a sentence and go, I have no idea what the hell my uh-huh. third word is going to be.
Yeah, I've
my
done
my third
that a
word.
Time,
to,
yeah.
it, and it's
you just
so,
start.
You just start, yeah. man. Sometimes it works out, and that's kind of like my style. I'm thinking, oh gosh, I really feel like an idiot, or what the hell am I? What is this? What am I doing? Yeah. So that's really funny. Confessions of a Therapist.
The guy that did mine and Bridget's premarital, who I think is great, and I did some counseling work with him and apprentice with him mm-hmm. even some, but he was he tells a story about a counseling session where a couple came into his office mm-hmm. and they came in and they said. They were having, it was marital, whatever. And they had a bad situation. They came in, they didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
And they walked in there and he asked them a couple questions and they talked for a while. And he said that he didn't know what it was, but he was just unable to speak or get one thought. He couldn't think of anything to say. So he would just look at them and he got so freaked out that he got and said, you had to excuse me for a minute. And went next door and told another counselor, like, I don't know what I'm doing here. I just can't, I have nothing to say.
Yeah.
I am just
was it
failing,
because their story,
I'm bombing.
Was it because the couple's story was like so traumatic or impactful
he just,
or
like,
hard?
I don't even know if it maybe was a spiritual thing, but he was just out of it. He just couldn't connect. Like, he couldn't muster anything to say. He had no advice. He had nothing. Like, he was just like deer in the headlights for the whole session. He said, and he just let them talk. And then he would just look at them, and then the other one would say something. So he left the room, had another guy talk to him. He's like, look, man, just go in there and do whatever. Went in back there, sat back down, couldn't get together still. Wow. Went through the whole counseling session.
Yeah.
And then the couple left or whatever. And then they called him like a week later and was like, that was
the most amazing
counseling session I've ever been to. You're brilliant. You're a genius. Yeah. This has been so transformative.
Yeah.
He's never said anything the whole session.
I mean, there can be like, room for silence and like intentional silence and, give time to sit with people. And then there's also, at least for me as like an experiential therapist, this whole theory, it's like you do things like that to be like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't mm-hmm. know. What do you think? What is, what are you feeling? And then you get into like, some more like unconscious stuff. Like, mm-hmm. what are you feeling right now? And then like, if you can let the clients know that you're feeling the same thing, it can be very transformative, So that's what it sounded like in that session.
Yeah. I think there's some tricks. Like, it's like hacks or rewiring stuff that go on there. Like, if you phrase things as a question, people are just so used to being talked at. That if somebody can just ask you a question and feel like they are really listening,
right.
That's not something you get like in a day. Am I going to get
that? Really.
Is anybody going to really ask me a question today and listen? Is that even going to happen to me today?
Not typically.
I mean, it'll be data transfer with me and my wife, and we may have a conversation today,
right.
But it's pretty low likelihood that she's going to say, how you're always thinking and feeling this about that? What do you actually think about this and that? I want to know.
What would you do?
That doesn't really even hardly happen.
If she said that, would you be like, you know, surprised or like, oh my goodness.
I mean, it's weird because it would be so endearing. You should just take the time to do that with other people, you know? Like,
well, yeah, it should.
But it's at least a shortcut. Like, if she did that, which maybe she does sometimes, you just feel like, oh, right. Somebody's listening to me, you know?
Because it's you've had a real transaction, mm-hmm. not just a, like you said, data transfer.
Right.
Good Lord, how cold is that? You data transfer with your phone as you type a text, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah. So, I mean, think about it. When's the last time somebody asked you a question and wanted to know the answer that wasn't just transactional?
Right.
Very rare, but it's like conversation, maybe hanging out, maybe watching a football game or playing poker.
You really have to be intentional about that stuff. Yeah. Like, when's the last time that I asked you or you asked me, like, dude, what's up? How you doing?
Well, that's too surfacey of a question for me. So I don't start
out
that.
But start out with that. Like, mm-hmm. Matt, I've noticed that XYZ and this and that, and I've known you for a long time. Let's talk about that for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
Maybe that's not surprising for you. I don't know, but.
Well, I mean, that's what I like about podcasting is it forces us to sit down and do stuff like this or talk about it. Or my favorite thing about it is when I just get somebody that I'm curious about information they have. So even though that may be relatively transactional, I love to engage with somebody that understands how a jet engine works because mm-hmm. I think I understand more than the average person about a jet engine.
Right.
Now I got somebody that can I know enough to engage somebody
who knows way more about it.
And they like that,
right?
Because then they get to talk about what they know about, and then I get to learn.
Right.
So that's the fun. I mean, maybe that's insincere to some degree, but that's just
why would it
that's
be insincere?
Like be.
You know a little bit, and you're going to talk to somebody else who knows way more.
Yeah.
That's just wanting to know something.
So, you know, that's weird thinking about you doing podcasting and more into that, doing the Stronger Marriages podcast and stuff mm-hmm. like that, but coming from a counseling background because that stuff like intentional pauses and careful speech is important. But, you know, you have to avoid being professional and stilted or whatever. But you seem like you already got a good grip on that.
Yeah, it was funny. I was telling Melanie like 2 days ago because we've been doing more Facebook Live events, you know. Mm-hmm. It's like I'm so much better doing the live stuff rather than some of the episodes that, you know, you came down and we recorded mm-hmm. and you're like, what is Seth saying? He's not even making any sense right now because I didn't have to be. I didn't have to be on, you know.
Yeah.
So like, so you did an improv class a while back and mm-hmm. like I remember you said that you were going to do it. And then I asked you about it and you said, yeah, you did it. But like, what did you learn in that? Because that makes me, when I heard you say that you were going to do that, I was like, whoa, that sounds exciting. Like, what was the main thing that you got out of that?
Well, I was, the main thing out of it is just like the humility of not really being good at it. Like, that's the main thing is you do something. And that's the way I think about a lot of things. Like, you got to do stuff that you're not good at and get good at it.
Right.
Because it's a myth to me. That people say, well, people always describe singing or acting or whatever it is, talent things. They always describe them as, well, you're just born with it, or I don't know, it's just natural to me. That's what everybody says, but that's not true.
And it feels natural because they practiced and like put in so much time and effort, and now it feels natural.
Right. That's right. So when they look back on it, they just feel like, oh, you got, or if you're in an industry or you're a record producer or whatever, then mm-hmm. from your point of view, you either got it or you don't. You don't take somebody that has some talent and say, come back in 8 years after you work really hard. They don't.
Right.
And this person does, but you don't know what led them to get to where they're at.
Right.
So it's a myth of that thing of you can't learn stuff or get better at it. And in fact, the hardest thing about anything is just starting.
Yeah.
You know, that's just the hardest thing. So with improv specifically, I know from podcasts and doing stuff with Toby and Joey and doing interviewing people that there's things I'm doing wrong a lot. Like I can feel when dynamics change or whatever. And improv is less about comedy and more about just the interaction part and helping the other person.
Right.
And not negating what they say and working with it and not shutting it down and working together.
So
but neither one of you know. And you can't – and the whole thing about it is it breaks down all the barriers of like you can't preload. Like if you cheat, it sucks. Like you need to start talking in improv when you don't know what you're going to say.
Right.
That's the only time it can really be good.
Yeah.
So it's really focuses people on positive, interacting with people, being totally present and not knowing and that being okay.
Maybe one of the powers of improv, or like I was saying, you know, sometimes I do counseling sessions and not even know what my third word is going to be.
Yeah.
It's like you're getting rid of everything.
That's right.
So you're shedding everything out, and then your interaction with that other person is only
exactly.
like
and you can
what
it's
do I
palpable.
Have here? Okay, let's go.
Yeah. Whether you're observing somebody else's interaction or you're the one interacting, it's palpably clear. Right. Like, right. And you know when somebody like, oh, that's something they always say. Like, you can feel that. It's just gross.
Yeah.
Like, that's, oh, what is that, some joke you know? Like, right. Oh, you have all those details pre-organized to say them? You thought of that while you were waiting
like
for your turn?
Writing. Yeah, that's just more not like right. a speech yeah. writing class.
Yeah.
So I remember taking a speech class in college, and there was, you know, one type of speech is called extemporaneous mm-hmm. talking, you know?
Yeah.
And that's just when you, blah, you go. Well, I mean, you have some kind of beacon points that you can hit off of?
For that is usually you find out your topic and you have like 5 minutes and you have to
right.
whatever.
So what kind of things, when you said that you were talking to other people, when I think of improv, I'm like, oh yeah, I mean, you know, you get up, like an open mic night, and yeah. you're like, hey, you know, and whatever, and you're just funny or you're bomb or whatever. So was
well, that's
it,
more like stand up.
So was it like monologue or
no,
was it like?
No, it's like this. Okay, so the premise is like you just have to make a sound that you've never made before, an emotion, and look somebody in the eye.
Right.
And it's humiliating, man. So you have to go, and now you have to mimic that sound that I did, which
right.
makes you feel super uncomfortable, and you have to do it back to another person.
Right.
And it's just an exercise in being a childish fool,
right?
And you can't do it good, and there's no great way to do it, and it's personal interaction. It's that's just like what you start at.
Did you think it was stupid? Were you uncomfortable?
Like I was
you were
very like uncomfortable,
this?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I can assume you were uncomfortable just because of the nature of it. But were you like, this is stupid?
Sometimes, yeah.
Really?
I mean, but it's just getting that's the whole thing, and it was just 101 level. What I'm saying is, I didn't get that good at it, like doing scenes and being able to make it go where you want to go. Like we didn't get very far, and I wasn't anywhere near the best one in the class, which
yeah.
is a little disappointing. I thought I'm good verbally, I'm fun, I'm funny,
right.
I understand the stuff.
I
should be
you're
able
good
to
when
be
you have,
good at it, but I'm not even good.
I think you're good when you have the element of control that you're used to,
right?
That's
right.
when you can jam.
Yeah.
You know, that's why you probably have your own podcast.
Well, I have things in my head that I can use, and so
right.
I use them. And even when I do music, I arrange and compose and spend a long time to get it just the way I want. I know what I'm looking for, and I can eventually get it.
Right.
Improvising, no, you don't really see me jam on guitar either. You know, and I don't do jazz improv guitar. I wish I did.
Right.
But that's a thing you have to learn to do. So I have to lay down all of my verbal or information crutches to do improv. So
yeah.
very, very useful though, nonetheless.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah.
You did?
I did, yeah. I'm going to do it more. I mean, I'm way into it.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't care about being funny or an improv performer. I don't want anybody to know. I wouldn't, good gosh, I don't want anybody to know
right.
that I do it, like, or show up.
Oh,
or,
sorry.
Like, I didn't tell anybody in my class that I have a podcast or I'm in a band the
right.
whole semester.
Well, you know what? Probably those other people have the same thing. They're just trying to get better.
Yeah. No, I know, but I just don't want them to think that I'm an entertainer here to, like, I don't want the people in my class to go home and Google me.
Oh,
you know,
right,
like,
right.
That, as far as they know, I'm just some goofball.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Because, you know, basically.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
That, you know, so, like, and I know that because I was in the band for a minute, like, you can Google and I come up for several different things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I had used to have a lot of private practice clients Google, because that's what you do when you get a therapist. You're gonna
yes.
like be intimate,
yep,
you know,
yep.
and all
you Google
emotionally intimate.
These days.
Yeah, and like they would ask these questions, and it was such a weird place to. Oh yeah, I was the drummer for, you know. Oh yeah, I did this thing. Oh, I did this thing, and then it makes you feel like.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now he's to run around naked and, you know, playing shows or whatever, doing stupid stuff. And now he's my therapist?
Yeah.
You know, so like that element. So I understand what you're saying. Like, you know, you go to the improv class. Oh, this is Matt from BC and Emery and all this stuff. You're like, you know.
Yeah.
So it just makes you feel weird, I guess.
Yeah, especially, yeah, for sure. It definitely does.
Yeah. What was I saying? Oh, so on improv stuff, I've always wanted to be in a play, but mm-hmm. I've always been like way too just deathly scared mm-hmm. of like being in a play. So last summer, had this opportunity to do a cold read of a script, and it was some play. It was a variation on Jack. It was a variation on Jack and Jill, who were mercenary soldiers in a post-nuclear.
Okay.
It was a hilarious thing. So we did the cold read, and like I was nervous throughout the whole time,
mm-hmm.
but it was just a reading, you know. And Melanie, my wife, was Jill, you know, so that kind of made it more. And she's really good at acting and, you know, singing all that stuff. But I found myself, I was like, I love this
yeah.
because I was scared to do it,
yes,
you know, and
right.
like just like, okay, I've never done this before. I'm going to suck at it, but I don't care. But then afterwards they were like, hey, that
yeah.
was pretty
yeah.
good for
you,
a first cold read.
You just have to
read.
Find a safe, the right safe environment to do something poorly. That's right. what you need. And then if you like it, you will get good at it. And when I, or you'll give up in 6 months or 8 months, and then you won't get good at it. But the amount of time that you stay motivated on a thing is pretty much how good you will be at it. Like if you're like, dude, I'm so into improv. If I, if 10 years from now, I sit here and say, man, I'm so into improv. Well, you matter of factly know I'm going to be very good at it.
Right.
Basically.
Yeah.
Because I've spent 10 years on it. So the only variable is, will I have the motivation to be doing it in 10 years? And probably not.
Right.
Which shows you exactly how much I'm good at and care about it.
Right.
A counterpoint to that would be my grandpa, however, who played golf 3 days a week his whole life.
He wasn't good, terrible. I remember.
He was terrible. My grandpa joined Greer Country Club in June of 1950.
Oh my gosh.
Or whatever, 54, whatever year it opened in January of that year. So he joined it 6 months after it opened in the 50s.
Right.
And played 3 days a week there until he died.
Oh,
or until he couldn't play golf anymore.
Right.
And he sucked at golf. Like I could beat him as a teenager. Yeah.
So that's basically a true golfer then. You know, you go out there and hack and you just love it, you know. So I mean was he like 3 days
never
a week?
Got
like,
good.
Damn it. You know, like hitting bad shots or whatever. No, he was like, yeah, I enjoyed my 18 holes, you know, 4 hours a freaking day doing it.
No,
like,
no, you just up there and just say breaks toward the creek, or, you know, hit a worm burner, or what are the other golf phrases?
Pulled it.
Pulled it.
Sculled it.
Sculled it. Chili dipped it.
Sliced it.
Just slice, hook, whatever.
So is there anything that you love that much? Like, what do you do recreationally?
I don't know.
I mean, even if you could afford it.
I don't know. I don't know. I got a bad habit of turning things professional. That are, you know, hobbies, kind of a thing. So,
well, that's kind of the dream, though, isn't it?
It kind of is. It bastardizes it a bit from time to time. Like, you know, I'm less into music now because I overdid it, maybe, or monetized it or professionalized it.
Your ears gave out.
Yeah. I don't know. But I mean, think about it from your point of view of like, I mean, it's hard to say. Like, you quit, for instance, you quit being in our band.
Right.
So, if anybody doesn't know, Seth was a drummer for Emery from. Dude,
the first 3 years, I guess.
Yeah, but even before that, this is pretty interesting, really. If I think about now that I think about it, I've known you since I was five,
right?
At least, if not before that, playing T-ball, and then I'm pretty sure you're the first person I knew that even played music or played the drums, and that's how one of the ways I got into music was that you and Austin would jam,
right?
And you could play the drums, and you could play the intro to "Smells Like Teen Spirit."
Right.
Which you were playing incorrectly. I retroactively look back and understand that
no
now.
No doubt, right.
But you could do that, and like you could jam on a Nirvana song or whatever. And that was when I said, oh, holy shit, music, let's do it.
Right.
Kind of thing. So we've been doing stuff like that.
So did I introduce you to music? Can I be thanked for
I suppose.
A couple of albums?
Let me thank you publicly now.
Okay, I was looking forward to that, so I'm glad it came out.
But you know, I mean, like, I wasn't any good at music. You remember that, right? I mean, you remember I was whatever. I mean, used to be a bully that picked on me and made fun of me, to be quite honest, if you'll recall.
Right.
I mean,
put you in a locker.
Right. That happened when I was in the eighth grade playing tennis, you know, and you were in high school.
Right.
So that, I mean, I don't know what you must have thought about me, but even when I started playing music with you, wasn't any good at it. I just wanted to play with somebody who
already knew how to play.
Well, neither
were we, so I was probably the only drummer you knew.
By a long shot.
Right.
I didn't even have a dream that somebody could ever do something like that.
Other than our other friend, you were the only guitarist that I knew.
And I didn't even know how to play at all.
Right, but at least you had one and were trying, right? Yeah. So it was like, hey, let's do some. And I remember you bought a drum set. And you didn't even play drums.
I bought it for other people to play.
I know, I know, which is like one of the coolest
things.
That's what
I'm saying. As soon as I figured it out, like, this is fun. Like, okay, and then eventually bought a bass amp and a drum set so it could be, because other people, I mean, it's just, why wouldn't you? Yeah, but anyway, that's been my mode forever. It's like, well, I'm interested in this, so let's do more of this.
So
that's all I do.
This isn't musically related, but kind of going back, if you kind of look at the frameworks of things, like systemically, like, okay, you were interested in something, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you wanted other people to be interested in it.
Right. That's right.
So you bought musical equipment so you could play with them and do stuff, right?
Right. But that wasn't about money. I didn't have any money. It wasn't like you bought it.
No, it wasn't about money, or it wasn't about
what
like,
is it going to take
I
to
be
do
cool.
the thing I want to do, and that's what it was going to take.
Exactly. You weren't looking for friends like, oh, if I, you know, get a drum set, Seth would come over more. Or, no, it wasn't anything like that. It was like, I think that's pretty visionary. But I bet.
I know my bum loser friends weren't about to save up for a bass amp.
Right.
They're not going to. They don't think that way.
So
Ronnie wasn't going
to
get them in.
Why do you think that way?
I just wanted to do what I wanted to do. And I know how to figure it out or just take one step at a time. I'm just right. I'm just driven to do the thing I want to do. It's relatively selfish. I mean, it's pretty clear.
And to get to that end, you power up, you enable, you facilitate yeah. other people to come That's along right. with you because you can't do it alone, right?
Right. Why would you want to?
Some people do.
Well, those people are boring. They're bored. What would I get out of being this expressive artist by myself in an apartment creating words and music that express myself to out there to other people? And what satisfaction do you even hardly get out of that?
Well, think about like a poet. You don't have to have like friends.
Sounds horrible.
Or a writer, you know.
Sounds horrible.
Well, there's a lot of them.
I don't understand why they do that.
Yeah. I'm just thinking of like even I don't know how old we were, 15, 14, mm-hmm. 16 or whatever. You just thinking that way and then like, again, looking through like systemic lens as a therapist, kind of like, oh, yeah, he's really done that in almost every arena. I mean, you're doing it right now.
I mean, we're going to make money off me and you talking like we got to have lunch today and hang out. So,
I know. So
good,
it's like,
good for me.
So that's what me and Melanie are trying to do, like lifestyle design, marriage design. Yeah, like just, do what you want, be able to get paid for it.
Well, most people don't really think you can't. They just don't. I mean, there's a combination of people that don't know that you can do stuff
right.
that could or would.
Right.
And then there's the people that don't want to do anything. Like, say this. What would be your ideal job? You could design anything and pay yourself anything. A lot of people would come back with a professional beach sitter, margarita drinker.
Right.
And I want to get paid $1 million.
Right.
Okay. Whatever.
Right.
That's a boring, dull person that doesn't want to do anything.
Yeah.
So what? I mean, that's...
Yeah. So I'm just thinking about, like, what... I don't know. It's weird because, like, do we gravitate towards what we really like? And then because, like, our system is set up, it's like, well, you can only do that on weekends or your vacation hours kind of thing, mm-hmm. you know?
No, like, I just would say you... I just don't listen to anything anybody says. Their actions tell you what they care about and like. There's
yeah.
nothing else to it than
yeah.
that. There's
yeah.
nothing else to it than that. I don't ever have any room for anybody to tell me what they wish they did.
Right.
I don't really... That's just kind of a meaningless thing.
Right.
Like, I wish I was an astronaut. Sure, I do. But clearly, I don't really.
No, you don't wish you were an astronaut.
Yeah,
you,
I would love it.
You wish that you could, like, go to space and, like, have fun out there.
Yeah. But I'm saying that's the same thing as somebody saying, I wish I could be a painter for a living or a singer or do music or do podcast, whatever it is. Even
right.
when people say, I wish I did what I do, I was, well, no, you don't.
Yeah.
I mean, or you could or you would or something.
Right.
And, like, it would not be crazy for me to say I want to be an astronaut because I could tell you, I could give you 10 reasons why I would like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I have, that's, it's nonsense. There's no supporting action to any of that whatsoever.
Do you remember after you watched that Coast Guard movie, you called me and like, you were like really, really, really wanting to be a Coast Guard person?
Yeah, the two things, and I told you another one I would do, if I had to go from scratch, I would want to be a Coast Guard swimmer.
Yeah.
Or a...
You mean a swimmer, the guys that like
rescue
jump
swimmer.
Out of the plane?
The rescue
the
swimmer for the Coast Guard. I'd
right.
want to do that job, or I would start a demolition company.
Right.
Maybe dynamite, build, like start small, build a company, and turn it where I demolish up big buildings eventually.
Right. So you're
That's,
saying...
Those are two things I think. I mean, of course, those aren't really true, I don't guess, but that's things I would say that I want to do.
If you were 15 years younger, would you... think that you would want to do that?
Probably not. That's what I'm saying. I really believe it when I say those things, but I don't think my actions support it.
Right. So you're okay. So you saying that is like, yes, I am the most 100% happy and certain that I am actually doing exactly what I want to do.
Well, close to it. I sure do wish it went down differently most times, but that's what gives you to get up the next day.
What would be different in it?
Well, I wish I had a little more income, to be honest.
Would so,
be
okay,
nice
to
so
make
know?
More money. Right.
I wish I spoke better. I wish when I listened to the tape back, I didn't hear the flaws I hear. You know?
Right.
But that's what makes me get up tomorrow and try again.
And that's what makes you go to improv classes so
right.
you can be better.
Yeah, and I like it. I mean,
right.
I like doing stuff. I like
right.
doing stuff with people. I mean, I don't even understand why who wouldn't fall into that category, but most people
well,
don't.
Well, tons of people.
Yeah.
That's just your thing, right?
Yeah, just doing stuff with people. It's
right.
fun.
Right. So. All right, let's talk about...
No, I wanted to talk to you, though, about quitting the band. I think we're on Emery's page today, so I don't
mm-hmm.
know if even people know why you quit the band, but it's crazy to me. You're an interesting person to me. I always tell people this. You're a family, a licensed marriage and family therapist with what are your degrees and point credentials or what?
So I have a, what is it? A bachelor's of arts in psychology with a minor in British history.
Mm-hmm.
And then a master's of science in marriage and family therapy.
Mm-hmm.
And then also was credentialed as a chemical dependency counselor for, I don't know, like a year and a half, but I don't do that anymore.
Yeah.
Which so, I had to go to school for that too. So 8 years of school.
Yeah. So the crazy thing about that is I tell people this all the time that Seth is crazy. He's a really, really funny and the most unlikely academic possible. Like, I don't think people get that. Like, I at some point would have said you were one of the dumber people I knew. That's probably true.
What do you mean dumber?
Like, you were like
not thinking.
Okay, so in high school you were just, if you think about it, if you were walking the halls of a high school and tried to rank people's intelligence, you would have scored yourself on the low side, would you not?
Of course.
You must have believed it yourself.
At one point,
you were a bad
especially
student.
After I got my first eight SAT scores back. Yes.
What was
I don't
it?
Want to tell
what
you.
What was it?
So out of 1600, right?
Yeah.
Because that's what they were then.
Yeah.
710. For real.
That's crazy. But I mean, your whole character and persona was just, Seth is like, you play dumb, you act dumb, you made bad grades, and you're funny. That's
right.
Just what you were doing.
Right.
But it was quite convincing.
I think I was
do you think you weren't smart or did it's weird.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's not like
the next step of that is you went to community college down the street and we went to a real college.
Community college.
You went to USCS.
Oh, right.
So you went to that college there,
yeah,
which was just a local commuter college.
Yes.
And what was your report card that time? It was so funny.
Oh, gosh. I got, I almost had to quit. My first and second semester were all D's and F's of college. Because I was a pre-physical therapy major, and I had to take a lot of biology. And like me and our friend Robert Stringer, we would like start biology and then look at each other and go, let's go get a sandwich. You know,
yeah.
So like all D's and F's, and I lost financial aid and all this terrible
but
stuff.
But you had all D's and F on the report
all
card.
All D's and
like
F's for two semesters straight, yes.
And the best was you took math 99, which was pre-college. Like, you had to take that before you could take college math.
Take a real
the
college
minimum
class,
one.
Yes.
And that math 99,
I
failed.
I took it four times. Four times. Yeah, so it was looking pretty bleak. And then I changed my major to education and then to psychology and then kind of got in a groove. Yeah. Yeah, it was weird. I never understood why you were at college. It just never made sense to me. I just thought, well, this is what I do. What am I going to do next? Right. And I never considered myself as like not a smart person. I just wasn't a thinker. I was very,
right. I mean, you're a very smart person.
I was reactive and proactive almost to nothing.
Yeah.
You know, and that's just what it was. And then kind of like, I don't know where it transitioned to, but it's like, oh, well. Okay.
It's really bizarre just looking back on the thing of it. And so then right after that college, you moved to Seattle to be in Emory.
Right.
Which is weird. And then you didn't really do that for that long.
No.
Kind of a thing.
I think I did it because it was fun and, you know, I was hanging out and it was more of a hangout. But I don't know. Again,
you never cared about it still.
I cared about it to the extent of like.
Like, how could you have the same experience as me and Toby? And then you're like, yeah, I'm out of here. Like.
I don't know.
You didn't enjoy. I still don't understand.
I think
to
one
this day.
Factor, one real factor was me and my, well, me and my wife Melanie. We weren't married then. All we did was freaking argue all the time.
Yeah, but I'm not gonna let you get away with that. I'm just saying you weren't that engaged with the music and the success and all that stuff. You weren't.
I was engaged with the fun. Well, you know what? There became a time.
I mean,
time
that
when,
was just
like,
an excuse or the time when you're like, oh, now I have a pinch in a relationship, and that's when you quit. But you clearly were never engaged to the degree that we were.
Well, I mean, I think I had spurts of being like really engaged, like, okay, going out and getting gigs and working hard. And I was interested in where the payoffs were potentially pretty big or really immediate. You know
but
what I'm
not
saying?
The music even that much, though.
No.
Right.
Not really. I mean, I like playing drums and like, you know, I really playing music in that way was really enjoyable and fun and like not even really being creative because, I created my own drum parts, but mostly it was just like, you and Devin and Toby, the main writers, like, hey, play this, or I couldn't. I'd get pissed at myself, and then, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know what it was. Even then, still kind of like reactionary to stuff.
Yeah,
it was fun to just hang out for.
And you wouldn't say either that you look back on it with regret. Like, you don't wish you were still the drummer.
No,
No. I mean, you don't.
No, I was talking to somebody last weekend, actually, because they discovered in the group that I was in that I was in Emory. I was like, yeah, it was whatever. And, do you miss it? Do you like it? I was like, I don't really miss it. Like, right when I quit, like, literally a handful of months after that, you guys, you know, got a Europe tour and, like, Australia and South America and mm-hmm. all that stuff. And I was like, shit, that would have been cool.
Yeah.
But that, like, oh, well, you were in a band so you could travel? That's not the right reason to be in a band, you know? And that was probably my main thing. So I was like, no, I don't miss it. And I wouldn't trade the experience of quitting or being in the band for anything. Yeah. Like, I love where I am now.
Well, the thing is, nonetheless, imagine how profound your life, not changed because of it, but like, I'll put it this way. Your life now is so different than your family's and where you grew up in a rural. I mean, you don't even sound like you have a certain accent. I do, but you don't even sound like you have one.
Yeah.
Mr. College Boy Professional. Doesn't even have an accent, really.
Well, what Southerners do I hang out with other than you and like talking to my mom?
Yeah. But but you live here in Seattle in the Northwest and are an academic professional. I mean, or I don't know if that's really what you'd even say it is, but it's so bizarre. And then you have traveled the world and the country. You've been to everywhere, you know, because of being in a band and seeing how, you know, just all the things. Think of how formative all the experiences you've had as a person are.
Yeah.
And you're just an insane example of somebody that can. It's not defying the odds because you haven't done anything crazy. It's not that. Right. It's just
compared to some. I mean, if you think about it, like, you know, I go on Facebook and, like, look at the people that we graduated in high school with.
It's so crazy where you are to me, like, just where you live and the set of experience you've had. And it's just, I guess it's all about just the broadness of experiences.
Right. Yeah, I guess the broadness and the depth and the breadth, too, of mm-hmm. those experiences. Like, yeah, do this, do that. Go here, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of opportunities in that, and I said yes to the opportunities, like, coming out here to be the drummer or going to graduate school or, you know, just doing all kinds of stuff. Traveling. It's like, yeah, I think it's just being open to those things.
Yeah.
I guess.
But it's just weird that a life can turn out that much different. Like your views or political views or social views and stuff are just so different, unpredictable. Like, I just don't.
I think that's
so weird. Like you worked with the natives. Am I saying that right?
Right.
That's what I want to talk about a little bit, but I don't even know how to get into the conversation. It's like so. Like you're so socially aware and I guess you're like almost a progressive or something.
I don't know. I think a lot of in this conversation, a lot of nature and a lot probably more nurture happened. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, tell me how different you are living in Seattle than Blue Ridge, South Carolina.
Yeah. Quite different.
Are you kidding?
Yeah.
And that's a transformative, and that takes a long time, right? So, like, my mom's side of the family is from the Catawba Indian Nation in South Carolina, right? Mm-hmm. I didn't grow up that way because we weren't allowed to go, we weren't allowed to kind of, like, that side of the family wasn't celebrated because of, like, the historical trauma of Native populations. There's a whole host. Again, I'm going to try not to get too much in the backstory context of it, but it's, like, important here.
Yeah,
I'm
kind of interested in
it. So there's a concept of historical trauma that...
Nobody else from your high school class ever talks about historical trauma in populations, by the way.
A couple
of them do, actually, I'm sure, but not maybe.
Historical trauma is the idea of, like, if you take a people group that has suffered from genocide, removal, you know, forced sterilization, boarding schools... all kinds of abuses. Mm-hmm. You take that. You take a population, and any population, you like Jewish people, Rwandans, whoever. Then there is going to be residual and profound effects, generation after generation after generation. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So in Indian country, we see the highest rates of alcoholism, suicide, sexual abuse, physical abuse, all these extreme maladaptive reactions. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because of what happened a long ago and is still happening today. I mean, you can see like the Dakota Access Pipeline, all this stuff. It's just a blatant, you know, dismissive, I don't know, human rights. And so, anyway, so that side of the family, because of historical trauma, they were never had a job. They were always drunk, and my dad wouldn't let us go down there, mm-hmm. right? And all my uncles, long hair, everything, couldn't do that, you know. So it wasn't really celebrated. So fast forward to out here, I work for an Indian tribe and with Indian people all the time. So that nature part, there's a lot of ways that I spiritually, physically, and emotionally relate to other Native people because mm-hmm. of that. Some people call that blood memory, right? Which is really an interesting concept. So coming out here, working for a tribe, relearning all this stuff about native spirituality, native ways of being, all this stuff, collectivist culture versus an individualistic culture mm-hmm. that I grew up with, right? So it's not you in a large part, it's like you within the part, and everything's a cog that supports one another. So I don't know where I was going with that, but even that, you know, just think about, like, if you went so deep back in your family history and learned so many things about different, you know, your ancestors, and go, man, I can really put those two dots together about what I feel, what I experience, and what I've gone through. Mm-hmm. It really kind of completes the puzzle in some way.
Is that a problem, though, like the way you said, and where we grew up? I'll put it this way. The typical person in South Carolina, rural, or at least us, or where I grew up, mm-hmm. their attitude toward generational trauma or whatever like that would be, well, that was then.
Right.
Now it's their fault if they're going to continue to be alcoholics. We give them a lot of money, so it's on them now, or something like that.
Yeah, I mean,
and you kind of grew up, even that would have been your
that
fault.
Would have been my perspective.
Even you would have thought and said that X amount of years ago, and people, if you went back and talked to people in your family, that's what they'd say today.
Yeah,
and then you've been on the ground and done all this stuff and the hunting trips and the almost an immersion in native culture.
Exactly. So you can't think that way after having seen and done and experienced all the things that I have with that certain mm-hmm. population. You know what I'm saying? It's like, oh, well, they get a job or this or that. And then you go on the reservations and you befriend, you know, different tribes and stuff like that, and you meet their grandmas, you meet their aunties, you meet them, you meet their dads, and go, okay, I think I understand why this is so hard for you. Because so when you said earlier, like, I never would have thought you would have gone to graduate school and all this stuff. You were the, you know, one of the dumber people in the thing, right? I was like, that's really hilarious. But
I'm only comfortable saying that because you're clearly not that and demonstrating that.
Oh,
here,
no. Yeah, so. Yeah. I was the first person ever in the history of my family, mom and dad's side, mm-hmm. to graduate college. First generation, right? You know mm-hmm. what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So even putting that together is like...
Devin's the same.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's like, how does that happen? I mean, you know, I had key people, you know, in my life that pushed it, not mm-hmm. from my mom's side, well, my mom did, but so it's all contextual. And if you take a minute and don't judge, I think, it's like the South is so judgmental. I think we're all judgmental. But you go, oh, yeah, walk, you know, go to a reservation, go do a sweat lodge ceremony and multiple sweats and all this other stuff, and be like, hey, I can see that perspective. That kind of makes a lot more sense. It's kind of like Mark Twain said, you know, travel is the death of bigotry, and I don't know the quote, but the point is, it's like when you have a wide breadth and range of experiences, mm-hmm. you can't think narrow-mindedly anymore, or you're an idiot.
Okay, all right. I'm kind of torn on what I want to talk about with that, because I kind of want to talk about native stuff a little bit more, because I want to understand it better. But sure. If that's true, where does that leave somebody like you, especially understanding where we came from? Because I feel like, in general, people here, the open-minded crowd here, the tolerant, open-minded crowd, mm-hmm. doesn't. I feel like they don't understand the South.
Right.
Do you agree with that, or you just look back as, oh, that's a regressive, poor, not good mentality in the South? Or do you think that there's something people are like, couldn't you apply the same thing?
Sometimes I don't understand the South.
But couldn't you apply the same thing? Oh, that's their culture. If you understood them, if
right.
you knew where these people that you're saying are racist came from and why they say what they do, you would understand that. Is that valid then?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's 100% valid. It's the same coin, or it's the same.
Because people hear a lot of, I don't get people to, I mean, maybe you say that, but if I run into a progressive crowd here in Seattle,
right.
they don't jive with that, yeah. what I just said.
You know, everything looks the same on the inside. It's just packaged differently on the outside. I guess that's oversimplifying it, mm-hmm. sort of. But there's no difference, you know. It's talking about, oh, the far left or the far right. It's like they're the same. They're just talking about different things and, like, very close-minded to each other's opinions. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So I guarantee if you took the most... you know, as you said, liberal Seattleite, or, you know, from somebody from Portland, transplanted them to where we grew up and go, all right, you're going to live here for 4 years. That's, you know, here's your mm-hmm. job. You make the same money. You have the house, whatever. You're living here for 4 years. I guarantee that they go, man. And they were halfway open to,
right.
you know, any influence or growth. Man, okay, you know what? I was wrong about a million things. Yeah. And all that takes is being open and then experiencing some of the stuff that you're, you know, criticizing so harshly. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
And then they'd come back here and people say, oh, you're more open now to racism? Great.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or something. Yeah, that's how they would take
it. So there's this funny thing, like with the people I work with, you've heard of microaggressions, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, just these tiny little things that kind of eat away at, you know, someone's self-worth or, you know, culture or whatever. So everybody.
That's what I'm saying. How far into all of that progressive culture? I mean, you're up to, I mean, you get it. And what I'm curious is how far in that, how much of that Kool-Aid are you drinking? Like,
what do you mean? How much?
I don't mean to demean that mentality by saying
like
Kool-Aid,
what do you mean? Like, oh, well, Seth is offensive.
No, I'm just curious. Are you about to say that microaggression stuff is silly, or are you about to go, no, and this is why it's important? That's what I'm curious.
You know? It is important. And here's an example. Like, okay, and you can relate to this. So everybody, anywhere you go, when they want to act like they're dumb, what do they do?
Well, I don't know.
How do they speak?
They use a southern accent.
Well,
to portray
what? Well, you're going there? What? You know, just like an idiot, right? And so, like,
if you want to sound like a dummy, just talk like Matt.
I know, just talk like whatever. It's like, so that is a microaggression. As silly as...
Damn it!
No,
Jesus
really.
Bastards, I knew it.
as silly as it may sound, but I got on to the people I work with. They were like, one lady was like, oh, okay. I was like, and I was just halfway joking with her.
Dude, I'm going to use that.
But I was like, hey, so-and-so. And I didn't like, hey, I want to be really respectful here. And like,
this is great.
You just kind of offended me right now. And I just wanted you to be aware of that. Thank you. Please don't do it again. No, I was like, that is hilarious because think about it. Every time somebody wants to be, you know, dumb, they talk like a Southerner, right? I'm from the South. You know, that's like a microaggression in a really maybe
microaggression. I would say it might be more than a microaggression.
Right. So I was kind of making fun of a microaggression, but not in pointing out to her, who is like, you know, ultra Seattle, whatever, like it's a microaggression.
Yeah, totally.
On any level of definition, you know, if you wanted to say, you know, use the Redskins, well, that's more than a microaggression. That's more overt, but or anything like that. It's like, hey, if I want to be dumb, all I have to do is talk like a Southerner. All right, cool. You know, hey, if I want to be black, then I, you know, spit out some rap. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, it's the same thing. So that's just a really, one of the examples that I just really keenly remember, you know?
Dude, what is the future of the natives? I mean, can they be helped? Like, because I think there's intelligent debate on both sides other than racism and things like that say, how do you help a population? So, is it possible to help a population that's been demolished? I mean,
yes. So even the way you talk about it, like how you just said, how is it helpful to help the natives?
What, no, not how is it helpful. I'm saying, how is it possible?
How is it possible to help the natives? Yeah. Doesn't that sound weird?
Not to me.
Hey,
no,
okay. So, Matt, I have a question. How do I help the women?
Yeah.
Just the women. Do you have any idea?
Yeah.
Or, you know, the blacks, those blacks, how do I help them?
Mm-hmm.
That's if I put it in a different context, it's just weird, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you can say, hey, you know, how do Native people need helpers? An Indian country is like as vibrant and as kind of colorful as any time in history.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe not any time in history, but right now, like there's so many things going on as like cultural revitalization and like, a lot of the tribes around here have casinos, you know, and you think, oh, well, they get casino money. No, that's not it. They invest so much of those millions, hundreds of millions of dollars into tribal infrastructure, into like education programs, into like college, in all kinds of like social services programs that are really helping Indian country, right? So there's this saying, it's although we've gone through historical trauma, there's also a burgeoning historical resilience, you know, and if you really kind of get into it, it's like, holy shit, so much has happened to Indian country as a whole in different tribes and specific things, so many abuses, so many just injustices, and for us to even be here still is such almost, I don't want to say a miracle, that sounds corny, but it's such a testament to the like that historical resilience, you know, and I find that in so many spiritual practices that I've been able to kind of like, I don't know, integrate into my self, I guess, like, you know, like sweat lodge ceremony, using different medicines. When I say medicines, like tobacco and sage and all these things, it's just like I feel closer to God than I have ever felt going to any church, going to any organized religion. Mm-hmm. And I think part of that is kind of like an innate spirituality, you know, like I was talking before, like nature and nurture. It's like an innate spirituality that blends nature and nurture just so close and so much. Like one of my favorite things is like sitting with elders, native elders from different tribes around here, and just like learning and just listening, because it's like, holy shit, so much like wisdom is there. You know, they could be tribal or non-tribal, you know, people can be wise, but just like the depth and intensity of like, man, you know. And I can get into like crazy weird things, you know, that a lot of people, at least I wouldn't even have understood it 10 years ago. Like, mm-hmm. that's stupid. What? You know, and talking about spirituality and how everything has spirit, and just like, it's so concurrent with like my version of God that I kind of always knew was there, but really the church didn't teach so much about, you know, because it's like, oh, that's trippy spirituality. You need to have this and this and vertical. And it's like, man, it's much more gray than I ever imagined. And in that gray, I feel so closer to, you know, Creator.
So you're hopeful for that population?
Yeah.
And then
infinitely hopeful.
And how does it, let's just say then, I mean, so the blacks, as you call them,
that was just an example.
Know, I know, but that with the historical trauma there, that's not that different with just slavery and stuff, right? So what's the differences and parallels in those two populations?
Well, there's many parallels, and there's many differences. One difference is like, well, okay, so you can even think about, so slaves, Africans were imported to this country, right? And, you know, different Caribbean countries and stuff like that. They were taken from the land. The land wasn't taken from them. Mm-hmm. And like many native people believe that like there's this like unbreakable connection to the land, because we came from the land, right? Mm-hmm. You know, it's talking about Mother Earth, or, you know, all kinds of different creation stories. So there's one immediate inherent difference. It's like taken from the land, or the land taken from them, and then you move, mm-hmm. right? And there's, I don't know, I don't have all my thoughts together on that. I've written about it a lot. And then think about, so historical trauma with at least indigenous people of our country, of the United States, is like 500, 600 years old, right? And the African-American population, that's from, you know, when did slavery first begin? I don't know, 1700s?
1617, whatever.
17. You know, or well, how about this? More recently, I don't know, 1800s. So there's 200 years versus 600 years, mm-hmm. of stuff. And you can see it. There's so many disparities between the black community and just the mainstream community. But the thing in Indian country is like, being the smallest minority group of the entire country, we represent the highest numbers of all these maladaptive reactions, right? So how can you take the smallest number of people and go, oh yeah, you know, those 10 people have the highest rates of suicide, you know, mm-hmm. versus, I don't know, you know, you could take all kinds of sample sizes and all this stuff, but, you know, there's just something there. It's like taking the smallest group of people and dumping on them. Well, they have the highest of everything. Diabetes, suicide,
stuff.
Sexual abuse, you know, early death rates for native males, 18 to 25. You know, it's like, it's crazy. And when you really get into stats, it's like, oh my gosh, how can...
Well, it's not like, yeah, I mean, it's not like you could say, well, they're, you know, they're bad people, and they, each one of them always chooses bad. And
right.
That's why they're that way. That can't
exactly.
be the answer.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like there are reasons for these things. You know, if your wife died, you're gonna see that.
Yeah.
You're gonna present with certain things, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now think if your wife died, and your mom died, and your grandma died, and your great-grandma died. Oh, yeah. And on top of that, a while back, you were forcefully removed mm-hmm. from your house,
right.
and
all right.
you don't
but
trust
then,
anybody.
But here's where people lose you there. They go, yeah, sure, that's fine. But my kids. Now, I'm the problem with that is I'm the parent of my kids. So
exactly.
I'm that person.
So you
and
are
now
that
I'm the
person.
Parent of those kids.
Right.
So you say, but that's different. They're, those kids are separate, or the grandkids of. But
right.
of course, we know that in how families work.
So in a collectivist culture, which is native culture, it's collectivist mm-hmm. society, much like, you know, Hispanic or, you know, other, I don't know, South Americans or Asians too. Collectivist cultures. No, individualistic cultures, European Americans can go, yeah, you pull yourself up by your bootstraps.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah, I went to school. I worked hard. I kicked ass. Yeah, I did it. So You're taking individualistic views and putting them on top of a collectivist culture and go, yeah, my mom was a drunk all day. I had to take care of my, two little siblings. And, we didn't have any money either, so I had to do that. So you expect me to go to college? What the fuck? You know what I'm saying?
What is that? Just pull the, it's this one over here. Just pull the power out of it. Sorry.
We're probably going over time.
No, that's okay. Yeah, we'll go a few more minutes. But the thing about it is I saw it on a graph the other day. So if you just look at that people, that the black culture, like this, if you look at the whole timeline, they've from beginning of slavery until they had civil rights in the 50s and 60s.
Right.
That's, you know, 200 or 300 years that only the last few have been even close to on, not even on equal footing, of course. But the direct oppression is all there's been for a ton of time. And it's only just a tiny, it's not only a couple of generations where it isn't that. Like people now's grandparents were harmed and oppressed before they had civil rights.
Yeah.
Like your grandpa.
Right.
So it's not even, it's insane.
It's insane to not
be able to grant what damage that is to a people.
People don't understand it. And especially, again, being a family therapist and looking at it through systems, it's like, if this abuse happened to so-and-so, and then it, kind of like residually happened to, my mom, and then, of course I'm going to feel the effects of that. And like one thing I didn't talk about is like during the So the U.S. government, the government relationship with Indian people here are...
And it's okay to say Indian?
Indian, Native...
First peoples is
I'm not really concerned about it. It's like some of the older natives prefer like Indian, because now it's kind of progressed like Native American, First Peoples. There's a million different names, right? Mm-hmm. I don't really think it matters. You kind of broke me on my train of thought there.
You were saying something about the U.S. government did.
Forced removal, genocide, Trail of Tears. All kinds of stuff, there's
smallpox blankets.
Can you imagine that? What if somebody wrapped your little baby in a smallpox blanket? What if an army general wrapped your baby in a smallpox blanket and she didn't die? Are you kidding me? Would you ever trust anything the government ever said again?
It's kind of amazing that they're not terrorists to us. Like that's how you make terrorists.
That's a really good point. Yeah, I mean, what are we doing? In the Middle East, creating terrorists with all so whatever. That's a really good point. I've never thought of it that way. Forced removal. So, Catholic boarding schools, there's a saying that the U.S. Army had about Indians in 1840s to 1860s, kill the Indian, save the man. Mm-hmm. So what the government wanted to do was assimilate all natives, do this white. And I'm not saying right, do it in the white way, not, kill the Indian, save the man. Right.
Uh-huh.
So there was forced removal. Thousands and thousands and thousands of Indian children were removed from their homes forcefully. And this was like 1910s, 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. Forced removal. So taking your kids, removing them forcefully, and taking them to a boarding school away. So
thinking you're helping them.
Thinking that you're helping them, right? Under the guise of we're helping them, right? Tell me you're not going to hate everything that's not, native, right? Yeah. Tell me you're not going to be ashamed of who you are. Tell me you're not going to go to drugs or alcohol or anything. So when these young people were in these boarding schools, there was massive amounts of sexual abuse, physical abuse. They couldn't speak their language. They cut their hair. Everything. So boom, stripped Matt Carter of who he thought he was.
Everything. Yeah.
Changed him. And the worst thing that you thought possible is exactly what you were trying to be made into. Right?
Yeah.
And then there's whole residual effects of that. So when you're in a boarding school away from your culture and parents, you don't learn how to parent.
Yeah.
You don't learn how to be. You don't learn how to do anything, right? Yeah. And then you come home, and then you have kids, right? After being sexually abused, physically abused, all this stuff, you don't know what the hell you're doing. And that is a lot of what we see right now with all these. So this is a really interesting story. So Melanie's great-grandpa, right? She's Native on her dad's side. Melanie, my wife, for the Stronger Marriages podcast, her great-grandpa was forcefully removed from his land up in Chippewa, up in Minnesota, right?
Uh-huh.
Made them go down to Nebraska. He escaped. He was 8 years old. Escaped Nebraska in winter with his buddy, who was also 8. So Mariner, my kid, escaped. And they walked the train tracks, a couple hundred miles. Got caught. took them back to Nebraska. Then they escaped again, walked from Nebraska all the way to Minnesota. Can you believe that?
Wow.
Your 8-year-old kid doing that? A skateboarding school. Do you think that there's going to be residual effects from that? Of course there is. You know. So just that whole story. And like I tell that story, it's like, that's somebody you know.
Yeah.
That's Melanie, your friend.
Yeah.
Her family, that happened to her.
Yeah.
You know? It's
yeah.
like, that's insane. So like, put it in context, coming from my family, first one to graduate high school, not like, I'm not unemployed. I'm not drunk. Not super drunk. So it's mm-hmm. we're breaking out of it, you know? So like sharing the and experiencing the positive aspects of Native culture is something that has enriched my life infinite, you know, and hopefully our children too.
Yeah.
So that's part of it.
Yeah, that's a weird thing. I mean, it's got to be one of the hardest issues to talk to people about, because nobody, it's just one of the most, I just think it's weird. It's one of the most oppressed, devastated people that don't ever get any press. Is there a reason for that? Like Jews, tons. Muslims, tons.
Right.
Black people, tons. Like there's great, I mean, genocides all over the world.
Well, you hear, but this
is one you just don't hear much.
Right.
Like, and they don't make a lot of noise, or I don't even know what it is. I mean, I'm probably say
no, there's
racist
like
stuff
peaceful,
to even try to talk about. I don't even know.
But. No, there's peaceful resistance. But think about, so even the Dakota Access Pipeline, right?
Mm-hmm.
The city, Bismarck, which is predominantly European, white, they vetoed it going through their land, right? Because of fear of like contaminated water and oil spills and death.
Yeah.
Right? So what does it do? Oh, we'll move a couple hundred miles south onto an Indian reservation. No problem. They won't care down there. And it's just ridiculous. So they're like digging up graves. Like imagine, I saw this one meme or something. Like imagine if, you know, we wanted to build a pipeline and wanted to dig up Arlington National Cemetery. People would lose their shit.
Mm-hmm.
Insane, right?
Yeah.
But with Native people, it's just like, I don't know. There's still residual stuff of like, They don't care. We can, you know, take their land, do this. So this just like, and it's
is
really.
Is it not in their culture to even make noise about it? Is that part
no,
of it?
No, no. There's like, I mean, there's different warrior societies, in fact, like warrior culture. Like, have you seen any of the Dakota Access Pipeline stuff?
Not
I've had
really.
Tons of friends
I'm not
that.
Informed on it.
Oh my gosh, you should. I've had tons of friends that have gone out there. Mm-hmm. I mean, been invited there myself. And like, just, I mean, they're raising hell out there in a good way, because it's like spirit led and like elder led, not something, you know, not like, you know, Mayday stuff. His
the problem
Seattle.
I have, I don't know. I can't speak on it, but I feel like there's the people that know about that kind of thing,
right?
And then most people just go, who are you for, the oil companies or the natives? And then
right.
everybody just likes to weigh in on it on the good side, but I don't think they know what they're talking
no,
about.
No, I don't think so either. And that kind of goes back to like, you know, the more you know about something, then you can like really speak cogently about it. Mm-hmm. And like it, not just like stupid left liberal like, oh, what? It's not environment.
Right.
Hate it. You know right. what I'm saying? So yeah. it's like you're not even thinking about it, really. Yeah. You don't even know.
Most people come to issues like that with zero possibility of thought.
Right.
So I'm not informed about it, but
right.
I know most people have minds are made up before fact number one comes in. If you're
yeah,
pro pipeline
point.
Or pro native on that
yeah.
issue, you know,
yeah,
it's just
and then
the
you can
is.
Argue either yeah. way, and it's circular and just stupid. So
yeah, there's some of the stuff these days that's just not really possible to engage in on the big level or the soundbite level, and that's why I think, you know, just talking like this is
yeah.
is interesting, at least because it's just a little piece, but it's a real piece. Like it's a circle all the way back what we were talking about before. Everything you just said sounds cogent, which I don't think we've ever had that word cogent on the podcast before. I like it. But everything you said sounds like you know what you're talking about. You have real experience with it. And it's just nobody could take the way you're coming across in a conversation as anything other than genuine. It doesn't sound like it's altered speech. It's like
right.
it's like the only thing
is that,
that
alternative facts.
No, it's not. I mean, just saying it's
right.
not even talking points. And I didn't even tell you we were going to talk about it. I mean, it's just talking to a person about a thing, and then to get to overhear that, or for me to hear it,
right,
it's just okay, it's just reasonable, it's just you being reasonable with some experience and information you have,
right,
and most of the forms of communication we get don't allow for the a time it takes just to get there.
Yeah.
Now, we could do this for hours, but we're just
yeah.
not going to right now, so we're gonna get out of here. But that is the interesting thing, is that we're not able Like, what would it take to be informed about the Dakota Access Pipeline? Something.
Follow them on Twitter.
Well, I'm just saying, it takes something to get informed. But listening to a person that you trust is informed from another trusted person that you know how to frame the context. Nobody thinks we're up here doing propaganda, for instance, right?
Right.
Like, I don't even know. I didn't even know what you thought about any of that stuff. And then if you're going to talk about it, it is what it is. And you're a person that we can say, okay, well, he knows more than I do about it. And I trust the conversation to not be false.
Right.
And I can tell by the way you are organized or not organized or natural that it must be genuinely sincere. And then I can put that in my own head. And now that's a real piece of something that you could put in your head to get to start to gain a perspective on a thing versus fact searching. Or whatever. I don't know. Yeah. I'm rambling, but somebody said.
So maybe it's like talking to a real person about it and like just asking questions.
But only if they're talking real, is what I'm saying.
Okay.
Not if they're giving a speech. I don't buy it.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. If you prepared that speech for me, I would have said, he's just espousing the position of these people for maximum effectiveness.
Right.
And it doesn't matter if it's true or not. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's the way that people talk that give you the clues and the context and the ability to listen to it. And that used to work with that propositional speech, but there's some amount of it we're just over. It's been used or abused too much to where you can't really trust a speech anymore. But I feel like I can trust what you're saying now, or just I don't have to trust it entirely. I can just take what I'm hearing you say.
Just think about it. Like, oh, well, that one thing that Seth said, I'm going to look that up. I'll just Google it.
Yeah.
You know, okay, what YouTube videos are out there? What, like, documentaries or anything
but,
like that?
But somebody said this point, and I can't remember who it is because I would like to attribute stuff to people. I'll look it back up, and it's something I want to think about. But check this out. We have the internet now. We have the information superhighway.
Right.
But information is such a goofy, small part of humans and human interaction. There's no, for instance, emotional superhighway alongside it,
or experiential superhighway.
Right. So that's part of the reason we're in this mess we're in now is because we've got unbelievable access, profound access, and turbocharged something part of the vehicle, the information part, but the emotional part and the experiential part and the connected part. We don't have some hyper transformative technology for that,
right?
For sharing those things.
So it's out of balance, really.
It's way out of balance,
right?
And you can see it spinning all out of whack with facts or alternative facts or truth.
And that only enables people to go, I'm heading full bore left. I'm heading full bore right. Wrong one.
Right.
But
anyway, I think conversation of people is very important. I'm not trying to say I'm important or this podcast is important, but these types of things are different. And I do that's why I'm attracted to it and like it and interested just to be able to have a conversation about you playing drums or natives or Indians. I can call them Indians now. That's nice to
either
know.
Either one. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm glad.
Yeah. I mean, it's cool. Like, I know some songs and a bunch of hand drums. Mm-hmm. I've made a ton of hand drums and just like, and it's all part of the spiritual, at least my spiritual experience in it, you know. And it's like we could talk about that
That's
forever.
Awesome.
But I remember you said one thing a long time ago. I think it was, you know, starting this podcast. I was like, oh yeah, I'm starting a podcast and I'm going to talk about what I want to talk about things that I like.
Yeah,
so,
there you go.
Okay, here we go. There That's awesome.
Go. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Huh.
I like it. It's good.
Yeah.
But we'll get it here. But Stronger Marriages podcast, you and Melanie are doing.
Yes.
I've produced it. I want everybody to go check that out. We didn't talk about it today, but no big deal. There's plenty out there about that. Go to strongermarriages.com/podcast.
Yep.
Or just find the Stronger Marriages podcast on iTunes. Seth and Melanie and I developed it together. It's a highly produced documentary style podcast.
It's a
12 episode season, and it launches next week. But there's a preview episode up today. It's about marriage, and you were on the Bad Christian podcast talking about the really bad stuff that went on in your marriage early on, and this podcast covers all of that.
It covers domestic violence, female to male domestic violence, lying, craziness, guns, just wild stuff, you know. So we really want people to go check it out, go download it, and our hope is that it gives you hope, because it's what we wish we had when we were going through just the shits, you know. That I wish that we had that when we were young married. Oh, geez. So, check it out. It's going to be a resource. So
cool. Thank you, Seth. Enjoyed it.
Right on.